The invention of flight has been one of the most profound technologies in history. And for the past century, it has functioned pretty much the same way. But that could all change. The advent of lithium-ion batteries and electric propulsion technologies is igniting a revolution in transportation. Everything from cars to trucks and buses are going electric. But what about planes?
We call this the third revolution in aviation. The first was the piston engine that enabled the Wright brothers to fly their first flight. The second was the jet engine, which only really was applied to larger planes. And we think the third revolution is electric propulsion.
CO2 emissions and the environmental impact they pose has moved to the forefront of public attention and has been one of the driving forces in leading electric vehicle adoption. The aviation industry is one of the fastest growing sources of greenhouse gas emissions, and unlike cars, aviation is often excluded from national climate plans because it operates across borders.
Between flight and commercial shipping constitutes about 5% of our total CO2 emission per year. And these are some of the hardest CO2 to decarbonize.
Aircraft emissions are a real serious problem. It's projected to be up to 25% of the entire global carbon budget to stay below 1.5 degrees C.
According to a 2018 report on CO2 emissions from commercial aviation, there was a 32% increase in emissions over the 5 years leading up to the study. And with the FAA estimating the number of airline passengers in the U.S. will surpass 1.28 billion by 2038, planes will be a big source of pollution for years to come. Jet fuel is also one of the biggest operating costs for airlines, and electric motors have fewer parts to repair and maintain, making them a more economical option as well.
When you look at a jet engine, there's thousands of moving parts. A turboprop has 7,000 to 10,000 moving parts, and you have to, every 3,000 hours, spend hundreds of thousands of dollars and a lot of time to overhaul them. There's one moving part in an electric motor in a plane.
An electric propulsion system can reduce cost of ownership or cost of operation dramatically, orders of magnitude, 40, 50, 60, 70%.
But not only do you have lower maintenance costs, but you also have lower costs in terms of actually providing the energy required to go from one location to another.
With so many benefits, why is it we have yet to see the electric vehicle movement come to aerospace?
So the fundamental problem with electric aircraft has always been that a good lithium-ion battery cell has 1/40th of the energy content of the equivalent weight of jet fuel. And so if you were to take an existing airplane and you take out all of the fuel and you take out the engines and the fuel systems and replace those with only batteries, then you would only fly 1/20th as far.
While the electrification of aviation has been slow to start, the technology is starting to look more feasible.
So there's been a significant enough revolution and improvement in the performance of batteries, which the automotive industry is really driving.
It is extremely promising that one of these battery technology can be scaled up for electric flight.
So the real question is not when will we have electric airplanes, it's when will the time come where we can have electric airplanes that fly far enough to then start replacing conventionally fueled air transport.
The first area to be serviced with electric aircraft will be short regional flights, but battery electric flight is still in early development.
Some of the planes that have flown have been demonstrated. They're basically all battery. They're just carrying their pilot, and they actually don't even have the weight to carry passengers right now. But the batteries are gonna improve.
Pipistrel is one of the few all-electric plane manufacturers actually building and flying today. Because of limited range and capacity, they're primarily used as trainer aircraft. Recently, Harbor Air in Vancouver, Canada, partnered with Magni X to take its fleet of seaplanes all electric. It just completed its first successful flight and is beginning the certification and approval process. Israeli startup Eviation Aircraft showed off its all-electric 9-seat aircraft in summer 2019 at the Paris Air Show. The company claims the plane will be capable of flying up to 650 miles and that customers have placed more than 150 orders. The startup hopes to begin testing in 2020.
There's companies out there like Bay Aerospace and Pipistrel that are doing, I think, amazing things in the light sport and the trainer aircraft market where they could go straight to electric with those vehicles, and the cost of ownership and the operational cost benefits are really, really compelling.
Until battery tech improves, hybrid electric aircraft is what will be utilized for larger capacity flights going longer distances.
A hybrid electric aircraft would be an aircraft that would leverage electric motor and electric propulsion in addition to the traditional fuel sources that we have today. So one can imagine, just like you would have a hybrid electric car, you could have a hybrid electric aircraft.
So what we've done is we've taken a very, very successful Honeywell helicopter engine and we've mounted it with a special gearbox to two of our ultra-efficient generators. So in total, this machine generates 400 kilowatts of power, which is enough to power 40 homes at one time.
Ampere is one startup working on and testing hybrid electric aircraft.
The first plane that Ampere flew is our electric Eagle, and that's a six-seat aircraft, the largest hybrid electric aircraft that's ever flown. We're already building our second copy of that aircraft, and it's going to be the first ever to fly on an actual commercial route, demoing daily operations in Hawaii.
The test flights will begin next year in partnership with Mokulele Airlines, flying on a route based out of Maui.
This project is a stepping stone for worldwide adoption of electric aircraft. So we've been working in programs from everywhere like Norway, where Norway is actually aiming to have all flights under 90 minutes go electric or hybrid electric by 2040. Looking at the UK, Scotland, initiatives going on right now to have electric and hybrid electric aircraft.
Airlines historically have struggled to make money on shorter regional flights, but hybrid planes could change that.
In a hybrid, we're reducing fuel burn by up to 75%. That is transformational for the economics of airlines. There's this whole segment of the market, about $40 billion of revenue that has now been eliminated from airlines' balance sheets because they just couldn't fly those routes profitably. We're going to enable them to fly those routes again.
Utilizing hybrid engines in regional aircraft could also make flight more common in daily life.
I think everybody knows how expensive it is to fly regionally. And part of the reason that this is the case is that small turbine engines are very inefficient. Electricity from renewable sources can be very cheap, and in parts of the country it's ridiculously cheap, like the Pacific Northwest. Compared to jet fuel, flying will be a bargain.
It's also going to enable is things like regional commuting, that you have these super commuters in places like Los Angeles and the Bay Area that are going to be able to do things like fly daily air pooling.
So when could we see larger commercial airliners go electric? It could be sometime.
I think there's a lot of years, if not decades, before hybrid electric and fully electric propulsion is going to be viable in that space. And it's unknown when battery technology will be sufficient for those longer missions.
And the takeoff, the amount of power that is required is specifically related to its weight. Even to have a small passenger plane, maybe three or four people, go for several hundred miles, you need a battery that is 2 to 3 times more powerful than it is today.
It's more likely that these larger aircraft will convert to hybrid technology until batteries are capable of supporting longer flights.
When you talk to a Boeing or you talk to an Airbus about a really big airplane, the conversations in the present tend to be around how do you make the airplane more electric versus fully electric? And that does take loads off of the engines and help reduce the fuel burn of those aircraft and make those aircraft more efficient.
Electric technology also opens up a host of new efficient designs for future aircraft.
There's kind of a cascade of benefits. You produce less heat, so it's easier to cool your system, and your cooling drag goes down. You can design the plane differently. The electric motors are tiny compared to an engine. You can put them in different places. So it just opens up an entire new design space.
If you compare the amount of energy per weight that you could put in a battery versus the amount of energy per weight that's in a gallon of gasoline, it's enormously different. And what that forces you to do is to design very, very efficient airplanes.
These efficiencies, in combination with the advantages of electric propulsion, enable an entirely new type of flight, air taxis, or urban air mobility.
Urban air mobility is really a new mode of transportation. I would actually call it a new era in aviation.
And that revolution is really to overcome the traffic problem we're seeing around big cities.
Perhaps you're 30 miles away from your closest airport, so you could potentially get into one of these urban air mobility vehicles and fly that short distance that might take you an hour in traffic, but maybe 15 minutes in one of these urban air mobility vehicles.
This new segment of transportation has attracted the attention of Uber, which is hoping to bring its experience as a rideshare company to flight.
We know that congestion is getting worse, and there's limits to what you can do on the ground. Let's move transportation out of the 2D grid into the third dimension.
Uber is creating the technology that will help run the logistical operations of such a service and partnering with manufacturers to provide the aircraft.
When you select Uber Air, we'll get you a car, you'll take that to the skyport, we'll walk you through the seamless minimal time transition into the aircraft, which will then take off, fly to the closest remote skyport to your destination, where a car will meet you just in time for you to get to your final destination.
Urban air mobility could surpass ground-based services in investor interest and funding. Morgan Stanley estimates the market could reach $1.5 trillion by 2040.
The evolution has been like nothing I've ever seen. I've been in aerospace for decades, and there's been an influx of capital at each end of the value chain, from the vehicle manufacturers, to the technology, to the infrastructure, to the regulatory environment.
Hundreds of startups have recently entered the space, all working to develop their own aircraft. Vahana is developing a short-range vertical takeoff and landing vehicle funded by Airbus. Joby Aviation is backed by JetBlue Airways, and Google's Larry Page is an investor in two startups as well. Traditionally, only a few hundred planes are manufactured a year. The advent of urban air mobility could change that and have a big impact on the automotive industry.
The volumes are going to be like nothing we've ever seen. In a traditional aerospace market, 500 airplanes a year, 600 airplanes a year, those are record-setting right numbers of airplanes, and for urban air mobility could be tens of thousands of vehicles per year. And quite frankly, the traditional aerospace industry isn't equipped to support those volumes.
Anticipating this convergence of aerospace and automotive led Honeywell to partner with Denso, one of the world's largest automotive suppliers.
We talk about urban air mobility not as a replacement for an airplane, but as a replacement for a car. And so you have a lot of automotive companies that are very, very interested in participating in the market.
We build millions of motors and inverters, and when we bring that kind of technology and manufacturing know-how to our aerospace customers, it's seen as really, really monumental because they are used to building in such low quantities.
Air taxis are only just starting to enter testing, but how soon could we potentially see them out in the world?
We do see some urban air mobility operations using conventional helicopters today. But when are we going to actually see these electric vertical takeoff and landing vehicles? My best guess would be as the technology develops, it'll be most likely in the 2035-2030 plus timeframe.
We've said publicly that we think that 2023 is an achievable date for launch of a real commercial service. It'll be a handful of vehicles starting out on key routes. It's going to start, you know, at a price point that's a little bit more premium.
But before air taxis or fully electric planes can be a reality, batteries still need to improve.
If we want a small air taxi to fly for, say, 500 miles, that will require a battery that has more than double the energy density of today's electric vehicle batteries.
Another roadblock is ensuring it will be safe and reliable under heavy use.
There are 200,000 planes taking off and landing every day. So the reliability of a battery-powered plane has to be very high.
As the technology improves, they'll be entering an industry built around heavy regulation. Aircraft manufacturing and systems are required to undergo intense certification to ensure reliability and safety.
This is no longer, you know, dad's little Cessna 172. This is a vehicle that needs that reliability and that safety to move people who are expecting that same experience that they would get in a 737 in a small vehicle.
Not to mention the logistical obstacles of navigating a crowded airspace. As more flight technologies come to market, there will be more aircraft in the skies than ever before.
Think about hundreds or even thousands of these vehicles flying around. They have to stay away from all the other traffic that's flying in the space.
So not only will we have to ensure safe operations for the passengers on board, but also for off-nominal cases, ensuring for the safety of the folks that are on the ground.
And with urban air mobility emerging as a new field in aviation, a whole new set of research questions and processes need to be developed between the FAA and vehicle partners. To address these challenges, NASA has created the Grand Challenge.
The Grand Challenge is focused on providing an ecosystem or a proving ground to enable not only NASA, but also the FAA, vehicle industry partners, and airspace industry partners to come together to really understand the key questions of what will be required to enable urban air mobility operations.
The hope is that together they can outline safety certifications, regulation, and integration into the national airspace and urban environments.
Seeing an electric plane as a prototype is quite far from a mass-produced one, unless there is a significant policy shift to put, for example, a cost on carbon emission. Battery-based planes will have to compete also with jet fuel-based planes. And currently, the economics do not work.
As planes progress toward electric technology, we should expect it to follow a very similar path to what we saw in the automobile industry.
where you, at one point, were talking about small vehicles like a Nissan Leaf, now you're talking about electrifying entire buses. And I think in aerospace or in flying vehicles, we're gonna see sort of a similar evolution.
You know, they stay in service for 30 years. The aircraft that need to be flying 30 years from now need to be in development today. I think that we will start seeing regional electric aircraft happen, and I think that will certainly be in the next 15 years.
Every type of transport is going electric, has already gone electric, and planes are next, and it's not just some far out future, it's happening right now.